we are called together as the family of God. Here we discover the truth that God makes no distinctions among us. So with thanks in our hearts, let us worship God. Let us now join our hearts in prayer. Shall we pray? Lord, be with us today as we come to you from all life's circumstances. Give us courage and strength to fill us with your love and grace that we may serve you effectively and fully. Through your light, may we illuminate the lives of those around us. As we feel your presence in worship today, may our knowledge of your divine mysteries continue to grow and change our lives forever. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. Every week, as we worship together, we have the opportunity to admit to ourselves and to each other and to God that we do not always live as we are called to live. In this time of confession, time of opening our hearts, let us remember that God is merciful and just, eager to offer grace and love. Let us pray first in silence. God of infinite mercy and love, we come before you this day, knowing that we have not always been faithful to what you would have us to do. We have too often turned our backs on those in need, choosing not to hear their cries. Forgive us, O Lord. We know that you do not want us to behave this way. Your love and mercy, so generously showered over us, should be a beacon to guide our own actions. We make no excuses, for none would suffice. We ask your forgiveness and blessing, turning us around and placing us on a path of compassion and peace. This prayer we offer in Jesus' name. Amen. We truly cannot come together. We cannot gather as a people of God without in some way sharing the peace of Christ with one another. So I ask that you now turn in your pews and smile and wave to others that you can see, greeting them with the name of Christ. Now if you join me with the prayer of illumination. God, source of all light, by your word, you give light to the soul. Pour out on us your spirit of wisdom and understanding, that our hearts and minds may be opened to know your truth and your way. Amen. The scripture reading today is taken from Matthew chapter 15, verses 21 through 28. And Jesus went away from there and withdrew to the district of Tyre and Sidon. And behold, a Canaanite woman from that region came out and cried, "Have mercy on me, O Lord, Son of David. My daughter is severely possessed by a demon." But he did not answer her a word. And the disciples came and begged him, saying, "Send her away. She is crying after us." He answered, "I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel." But she came and knelt before him, saying, "Lord, help me." And he answered, "It is not fair to take the children's bread and throw it to the dogs." She said, "Yes, Lord, yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table." Then Jesus answered her, "O woman, great is your faith. Be it done for you as you desire." And her daughter was healed instantly. May the Lord bless this reading of Holy Scripture.
Thank you, John, for sharing that story. scripture with us and for acting as our liturgist this morning. Joan reminds me, she's standing up here, that a lot of people are getting into the matching the masks with your outfit. Yeah, I can see several of those as I'm looking out around the congregation this morning. So I don't know how long these masks will be a part of our lives, but they certainly are now. This particular scripture that Joan just shared with us this morning, this story from the Gospel of Matthew, is an uncomfortable story for most of us as Christians. As a matter of fact, if you don't find it somewhat uncomfortable, I think maybe you missed the point of what's going on in this particular story. The story is uncomfortable because we're confronted by a Jesus who's not very nice in this particular passage. This Jesus at first completely ignores this woman who's in obvious pain, and then he sort of speaks over her in derogatory terms, and then he seems to take almost a racist attitude towards her in his dealing with this woman. It's not a real nice portrayal of Jesus if you read this story, this very short story, carefully. You know, we'd much rather have a Jesus who is warm and cozy and loving, a Jesus who's ready to show compassion and mercy at the drop of a hat. But would really be twisting the text here considerably to portray Jesus like that here. That's just not how he's portrayed. And then secondly in this story, we're confronted by the disciples of Jesus who show a distinct lack of compassion themselves. They seem to think that they're better than this woman. They're annoyed by her presence and they say, just send her away. Get rid of her. You know, our picture of the disciples is the disciples sitting earnestly at the feet of Jesus, learning from him, and then themselves showing the love of God to all others who are in need. But once again, you'd be twisting the text considerably to portray the disciples like that in this particular story. So yes, this is a deeply uncomfortable story. So what do we as Christians here in a Christ-centered church, what do? With this uncomfortable story. Shall we pray? Gracious God, may the words of my lips and the meditations of all our hearts and minds be acceptable in thy sight, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Well, here in this story, we're told in verse 21 that Jesus went away to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Now, we're not familiar with the geography of the Middle East 2,000 years ago, but you need to know that these two areas are far to the north of Galilee, where Jesus and the disciples were from. They are way up to the north, out of the area of what we traditionally think of as Galilee, and these are actually Gentile regions. So the disciples and Jesus, they were out of their comfort zone, out of the physically geographic area in which they were used to living and moving around. They were amongst Gentiles with whom the disciples had little or nothing in common. And I would guess, being in that area, the disciples felt nervous and maybe even agitated being in such strange surroundings. Here they are in the middle of a foreign region, outside of their comfort zone, and this woman comes after them yelling and pleading for help. This was not a Jew, this was a Gentile and a Canaanite. And it was not a man either, but a woman. And no self-respecting woman would talk to a man the way this woman was talking to Jesus, let alone a Gentile woman talking to a Jewish man before being spoken to herself. It just wasn't done in society at this time. So this is a deeply uncomfortable situation for all the actors involved in this story. All the societal rules are being broken. Everyone, the disciples, Jesus, and the woman, are all outside their comfort zones. And so this woman comes behind them and is yelling out to Jesus to help her. And what is Jesus' response? Nothing. Absolutely nothing. Verse 23 says, but he did not answer her at all. How could Jesus appear so indifferent to the genuine anguish of another human being? Well, we can come up with all kinds of theories that try to justify Jesus in this moment. Theologies that defend him from looking bad in our Christian eyes. But the truth is, this passage of text doesn't give us any idea of why Jesus said nothing. The truth is that we just don't know what is going on in Jesus' mind at this point. So the disciples, when Jesus says nothing, the disciples, well, they just urge Jesus to send the woman away. And to be honest then, his next reply in verse 24 doesn't really help matters any, because he says, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now, evidently Jesus didn't completely agree with the disciples' position that he should just send her away, because he didn't send her away. He actually replied to the woman. He starts talking to her, sort of to her. They enter into somewhat of a dialogue in the rest of this particular story. The woman continues to say, you know, Lord, help me. As a matter of fact, it says she comes before him and kneels in front of him and says, Lord, help me. There's such agony in her request, such pain. Seems as if she has no more words to say. She's not asking for herself. She's asking for her daughter. And she's asking for help. And what we want here is for Jesus to pick her up, say, get up, woman, and maybe give her a big hug and respond out of some kind of deep compassion and just give her what she needs, right? That's what we want to happen. But Jesus doesn't do that, at least not immediately. Instead, he makes this further statement that seems to almost humiliate her in front of the disciples. In verse 26, Jesus says, it's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. He's calling this woman a dog in what he's saying. What a cruel response, you know? A humiliating reply. Not even addressing her pain, but to suggest that she's somehow less than human. She's no better than a dog searching for scraps underneath a table. It's not the picture of Jesus that we usually have. It's not the nice, kind, compassionate Savior that we think about. But that's what we're confronted with in this story. But even with that, even being after being insulted and called the dog, the woman doesn't give up yet. She seems to throw Jesus' words sort of back toward him. And she says, yes, Lord, but even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. You know, she seems to be saying, well, surely there's enough to go around, isn't there? So that I can get some crumbs so that my daughter can be saved. My friends, this uncomfortable story, it comes right after the feeding of the 5,000. Remember, I talked about that 2 weeks ago. And it comes immediately before the next great miracle feeding story of Matthew, where Jesus is going to feed 4,000 people. With this time, I think it's 7 loaves and a few fishes. I don't think Matthew places this story about the Canaanite woman in between those great massive feedings by accident. He does it very purposely. I think there's a clear message here about the abundance of God that transcends all social and racial and gender boundaries. The abundance of God cannot be contained or fenced in. There is more than enough to go around. And here's the really controversial teaching in this story, in this short passage. It's Jesus's final response to the woman. In verse 28, he says, "Woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish." Now, wait a minute, Pastor Steve, you might be saying, why is that so controversial? Well, let me tell you. The reason that is so controversial, because this woman in this story had not come to faith in Jesus in the sense that she was prepared to forsake her Gentile heritage and come within the boundaries of the Jewish religion. Nothing like that at all had happened. Culturally, she remained exactly where she was. She was asking Jesus to reach out to her into her cultural setting and to meet her right there, her and her daughter. So if you think about it, who is challenged? Who is stretched in this story? It's not the Canaanite woman. No. It is Jesus himself who is challenged. Jesus, who just a few minutes before had said he came only to the lost sheep of Israel. It is Jesus in this story that we see having his identity and his role as Messiah stretched to include all people. Jesus is enlarging the boundaries of his mission to encompass the outsider. It is not the case that the outsider comes into Jesus' area and into Jesus' preset mission boundaries. No, the outsider stays an outsider. The outsider retains her own culture. And Jesus says, still, you are a woman of faith, and it will be done as you wish. She doesn't become a Jew. She doesn't even necessarily become a follower of Jesus that we know. But Jesus still reaches out to her and provides for her daughter. And that is what is so radical in this passage. And I believe what should give us a sense of challenge today. I think that's what makes this really an uncomfortable story. Because the temptation for us is to expect others to come and join us. Come and join us right here in church, anytime, but on our terms, not on the other person's, the outsider's terms. You know, we want new people in church, right? We want new people to come and join us. We want people to become Christian and to join First Presbyterian Church right here in St. Genevieve. And we offer the hand of friendship and welcome to them. But ultimately, we want them to join us and to accept our ideas, and to accept our rules and our social conventions. And if you think about it, that's sort of the story of Christianity and the Christian church throughout history. You are welcome to join, but here are the rules. Here's what you're supposed to follow. You've got to change yourself into this. These are the rules of behavior that we have for you, that we expect of you. You know, many churches sort of operate like a clique where people are expected to conform. in order to belong. But that's the exact opposite of what happens in this story, this uncomfortable story. Here, Jesus reaches out to meet the woman right in her own culture. He does not ask her to change. He does not ask her to be something other than what she is. He doesn't ask her to join his club. He doesn't set any standards in order for her to be welcome into the love of God. He accepts her just as she is. And he shows compassion and grace and allows her to continue in her own cultural way of being. I think that's why the story is set up the way it is, where we recognize this woman's otherness. She's completely different, and the disciples want to kick her out. And Jesus even seems to put her down, because he comes from that Jewish culture, from that Jewish heritage himself. And this Canaanite woman is looked down upon. She is like a dog in comparison to the dominant culture of the Jews. And once this is pointed out very starkly to us, even by the behaviors of Jesus himself, then Jesus accepts her and accepts her faith right where she is. So perhaps being a Christ-centered church means that we don't put boundaries around ourselves. Instead, we should be prepared to dismantle the boundaries. We should get rid of the idea of it's us versus them that we hear so much today in our own society and culture. And we should proactively choose to learn from others with different ideas so that we can grow together as a people of God with all of our differences. And differences are okay. Even with our different expectations of church and of God. I said this is a deeply uncomfortable story, and I believe really that it is. It's uncomfortable because we don't really like the arrogance of the disciples. It's uncomfortable because we struggle with the way that even Jesus is depicted in his words and actions in this story. But ultimately, I think it's uncomfortable because we are confronted with the idea that an outsider should teach Jesus and the disciples, and that means us, help teach us what it means to embrace in fullness the mission of God. It's uncomfortable because we're confronted with the reality that we have a great deal to learn from outsiders, and that if we want to truly be Christ-like, we have to embrace outsiders. Not so that they can become like us, but so that we can learn more about God from them. My friends, I think it's a brave church that seeks to be truly Christ-centered, because that means we'll be forced to change and grow in ways that we never thought we ever would. We might have even never thought were possible before. But I think there's really no alternative. If we want to mirror the ministry of Christ, if we truly want to follow the way, the truth, and the life, that's who we should be as Christ-centered Christians. Thanks be to God. Amen. As Sharon plays our special music this day, I want to challenge you to ponder how this church might truly mirror the ministry of Christ. What is it that we need to be doing to really be following the way, the truth, and the life? Sharon. Thank you. Foundations and the Book of Confessions, part of the Constitution of the Presbyterian Church. It is a brief statement of faith that was actually written and adopted in 1992. Listen now to this statement by which Christians, and particularly Presbyterians, because this is definitely a Presbyterian statement, way in which we affirm our faith, affirm what we believe. In life and in death, we belong to God. Through the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit, we trust in the one triune God, the Holy One of Israel, whom alone we worship and serve. We trust in Jesus Christ, fully human, fully God. Jesus was crucified, suffering the depths of human pain and giving his life for the sins of the world. God raised this Jesus from the dead, vindicating his sinless life, breaking the power of sin and evil, delivering us from death to life eternal. We trust in God, whom Jesus called Abba, Father. In sovereign love, God created the world good and makes everyone equal in God's image, male and female, of every race and people, to live as one community. Loving us still, God makes us heirs with Christ of the covenant. Like a mother who will not forsake her nursing child, like a father who runs to welcome the prodigal home, God is faithful still. We trust in God the Holy Spirit, everywhere the giver and renewer of life. In a broken and fearful world, the Spirit gives us courage to pray without ceasing, to witness among all peoples to Christ as Lord and Savior, to unmask idolatries in church and culture, to hear the voices of people long in silence, and to work with others for justice, freedom, and peace. So with believers in every time and place, we rejoice that nothing in life or in death can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus our Lord. Glory be to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit. Amen. We now turn together to a time of prayer. So we will pause for a moment of silence before this prayer, and I will remind you that at the end of this pastoral prayer, I will invite you to join with me in the Lord's Prayer, which you find printed in your bulletin there this morning. Shall we pray? O God of all creation, we begin this prayer with gratitude. Gratitude for all the ways we have been touched by your grace in this past week. We celebrate life's simple pleasures, waking up refreshed, a phone call with a friend, laughter over silly things, sunset walks, a beautiful, beautiful morning, the gift of life itself. During this time, we pray that we will never again take for granted the opportunity to worship side by side, the ability to greet a stranger, a hug with a friend, even a boring day. So we thank you, our God, for all the beauty that lifts our spirits and the kindness that continues to spring up all around us as we can collectively breathe in your Spirit this morning. Precious Lord, you are the God of life who sees us as our perfectly imperfect selves, and yet you love us just the same. You continue to invite us to come to you, to trust you, to surrender ourselves into your care, and we give you thanks. O loving God, we learn that there is little in life that we cannot bring to you in prayer. Right here in the midst of this gathered community are so many needs. So we pray for each of the vulnerable that we have living all around us, all those that we have mentioned by name this day, and those who continue to be in our hearts and minds that we have not named this day. Grant them comfort in this life of uncertainty. We especially pray again for the healthcare workers, for all the first responders who continue to work long hours with their greater risk of contracting this coronavirus themselves. So we ask that you renew their energy and that you sustain them well during these times of pandemic. And for each one who is bowed down with an anxiety about tomorrow's problems, well, give us some peace, our God. Shelter each of us in the embrace of your Spirit, that we might know that we are never alone. And remake us into the ones who choose gratitude and service and hope. And as we leave this place today, renewed by word and by scripture and by prayer, help us to never forget that you have blessed us in order that we might be a blessing to others. Through Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray together, we say, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. I forgot to mention at the beginning of the service, so I'll mention it now at the end of the service. You may have noticed across the back right there, there is only Rhonda. There are no Schaefers at all back there. The entire Schaefer family has gone on vacation, and we hope that they have an enjoyable week this week. And I appreciate Rhonda filling in as our video person today, as well as wearing the hat or the face mask of Deacon of the Month. So thanks, Rhonda, for doing that for us this day. Once again, we didn't pass the plates this morning, but Jacob, we haven't forgotten about you. If you have a way that you want to give a tithe or offering to this church, the plates are available right by the door before you leave this day. And we thank all of you for continuing to support our church and its ministries with your tithes and with your offerings. So with that, let me offer this blessing for our tithes and offerings. O Lord, help us all to be generous givers of our money and of ourselves, that this money and that we might make a difference in this world. We thank you, gracious God. We ask that you accept not just our tithes and offerings, but also ourselves, freely offered in gratitude for all you have done for us. Use them in this town, in this place, throughout this world, wherever you might lead us. It is in the name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. So my friends, I hope it's still a beautiful day outside, because I'm getting ready to go out there and greet you as you leave. I hope you have a wonderful week this week. Are you back to work now? Yeah, teacher, I know the school can't start that until the following week, but people are getting ready for some big changes coming up here in our society. If you haven't taken off yet, you still don't leave until next week, right? Okay. So we want to keep all those in mind that are making preparations for some major adjustments in life. There are always major adjustments at this time of year, but even more so in these days of uncertainty, not knowing what's going to happen. So keep all of those that are affected by school openings and everything else in your thoughts. thoughts and prayers this week and this month. Wherever you find yourself this week, it's supposed to have some beautiful days. I don't know how the Shakers picked the perfect week to go on vacation, but it's supposed to be a beautiful week this week, and I hope that you're able to get out and enjoy yourself in the week. And always remember that regardless of what you're doing, regardless of where you are in your life, that God is always right there with you. Because God is always above us, watching over us. God is always below us, supporting us and holding us up. God always goes behind us to protect us. God always goes before us to help lead us, if only we will follow his guidance. And God is always right beside us to give us a hug, loving embrace when we most need it. And most importantly of all, God is always inside us to bring us joy and peace. So go in peace this day, my friends. Amen.